Warning: this experiment generates toxic sulfur dioxide gas. Work outside in a fume hood. This experiment also uses hydrochloric and sulfuric acids. Wear gloves when handling them. Greetings, fellow nerds. In this video, we're going to show three ways to make sulfur dioxide. By itself, sulfur dioxide is rather unwanted since it's toxic, makes acid rain, damages the catalytic converter in cars, and is overall not a pleasant substance. It's mostly used by the amateur chemist as a precursor to making sulfuric acid, and occasionally as a gaseous reductant. It finds some use among metal refiners as a cleaner way to reduce or drop precious metals than sodium metabisulfite. I've demonstrated multiple ways to make it over the years as part of other videos, but I thought I would assemble them into a compilation video so the processes are easier to search for on YouTube. So let's get started. The first and by far the cheapest method is simply to burn sulfur. I have it packaged in a toilet paper roll to make a crude sulfur candle, and all we have to do is set on fire. Granted, it does need to be molten for the flame to be self-sustaining, but that isn't too hard to do. Elemental sulfur is actually rather easy to get for gardening uses and pest control. The flame is very dim, but it is there and it can be seen if you turn out the lights. The reaction is very simple, it's just combusting with oxygen to make sulfur dioxide. Anyway, burning sulfur is cheap, but by itself it's useless since you need to direct the sulfur dioxide produced. So we need to build a gas capture setup. We start with a metal funnel over the burning sulfur, and to that we connect a long coil of copper tubing using some aluminum duct tape. I know this looks pretty stupid, but the copper tubing is to cool the hot sulfur dioxide gas that just came off the candle. You actually don't need this much tubing. I found the gas sufficiently cool after just 2 meters of tubing, or about 6 feet. I was just too lazy to cut my tubing down. Anyway, it's then connected using easier to bend plastic tubing to the reaction flask where we have whatever chemicals we want to react with. Now the gas won't push itself into the apparatus, so instead we pull it using a vacuum by connecting the reaction flask to a vacuum adapter. Here's a close-up of the adapter. As we pull a vacuum through the adapter, gas is pulled down through the top of the adapter and into our reaction through that inner tube. The same tube that connects to our cooling apparatus. This allows us to use sulfur dioxide without having to build a sealed combustion chamber. We've already shown how to make a fairly cheap aspirator vacuum pump in a previous video for use with this setup. If your reaction is safe toward the metals of the aspirator pump, you can also use the aspirator pump itself as a reaction vessel and simply add your chemicals to the pump water. But I personally don't recommend this as contaminating your aspirator pump apparatus with chemicals is messy and more headache than it's worth during cleanup. A special note if you're using the aspirator pump setup, you'll need to put your vacuum pump outside or in a fume hood as a small amount of sulfur dioxide will get pulled into the pump and exit out the exhaust. So do not have it in the main workspace of your lab or you'll get gassed with sulfur dioxide. Anyway, that's how we make and utilize sulfur dioxide from burning sulfur. It's the cheapest source of sulfur dioxide, but it is somewhat involved since we have to make this gas capture setup to use it. But if you're using very large amounts of sulfur dioxide for large-scale reactions, this might be the best and most economical method for you. The next method I want to demonstrate is the sulfuric acid decomposition method. In this method, we get concentrated sulfuric acid and add elemental sulfur to it. Then we build around it a sealed distillation setup with the gas line serving as our output of sulfur dioxide. This line is led into our reaction. To use the generator, we turn on the heating high enough to gently boil the sulfuric acid, but not hard enough to distill it. At this temperature, the sulfur and sulfuric acid react to produce sulfur dioxide in water. This reaction is actually called comproportionation, which is the exact opposite of disproportionation. As you can see, it consumes sulfuric acid and sulfur, so if your objective is to make sulfur dioxide to in turn make sulfuric acid, this reaction is probably not the most efficient. The reason why we built the whole distillation apparatus around it is to cool the hot sulfur dioxide as it comes out. Additionally, the reaction will generate small amounts of water that boil out. A big problem though is that at these temperatures, small amounts of sulfur will vaporize and condense onto the inner walls of the distillation apparatus, clogging it up over time. You can minimize this by using a large flask and trying to adjust the temperature just right that it's just enough to boil but low enough to keep most of the sulfur from vaporizing into the condenser. Overall though, I find this method more trouble than it's worth. It's rather slow and concentrated sulfuric acid is too valuable for the amateur to waste on making sulfur dioxide when the burning method can be used. On a safety note, dealing with boiling hot sulfuric acid has its own dangers that most amateurs just shouldn't risk. But this method does have the advantage that the sulfur dioxide is rather pure and doesn't have large amounts of air with it. For some reactions, having air may be a problem. In terms of cost, it is cheaper than the metabisulfite method I'll show later, and for cost-sensitive work like precious metal refining, this might be important. Additionally, not needing a vacuum pump may be desirable for some. You just need a hot plate capable of boiling sulfuric acid. It doesn't even need to stir. So that leaves the final and most expensive method, sodium metabisulfite acidification. To make the generator, we start with some water, and for this example, we'll start with 100 milliliters. To this, we add 95 grams of sodium metabisulfite. On top of this, we set up a gas adapter and pressure equalized dripping funnel. To the funnel, we add 120 milliliters of 10 molar or 30% hydrochloric acid and seal it. You can multiply the ratio to whatever you need for your application. To use the generator, we just open the valve and drip in the hydrochloric acid. The acid reacts with the sodium metabisulfite to generate sulfur dioxide and salt. We can then lead the sulfur dioxide into whatever reaction we want. And the drip rate loosely controls the generation rate. This method is rather expensive in terms of reagents, but it's tremendously convenient since the sulfur dioxide is produced instantly on demand, and you don't have to wait for the generator to heat up like the sulfuric acid decomposition method. The setup is very straightforward and the gas is already room temperature and reasonably pure. We don't need unwieldy coolers, high temperatures, or complicated vacuum pumps. Sodium metabisulfite might seem exotic, but it's readily available online and there isn't much restriction on it. For some amateurs, it's easier to obtain than sulfuric acid. It's used a lot as a disinfectant and preservative in food preservation and storage. You've seen me use this method pretty much exclusively for all the times I've needed sulfur dioxide, and while it is expensive, the convenience is worth it for most cases. So that was three ways to make sulfur dioxide gas. Thanks for watching. Special thank you to all of my supporters on Patreon for making these science videos possible with their donations and their direction. If you're not currently a patron but would like to support the continued production of science videos like this one, then check out my Patreon page here or in the video description. I really appreciate any and all support.